Welcome to Latest TV's number one show, the People's Republic of Brighton and Hove, radio show
Hove, yeah.
On the television. Hello, Debs, how are you?
Hello, I'm very well, how are you?
I'm fine, actually, thanks for asking.
I always want to check how you are, my friend. I want to check how you are.
Thanks, mate.
We have got such a fun packed show. We are going to crack on with our first guest. We really should.
Let's crack it.
The wonderful Emily Kennedy Barnes, founder of Funny Frog Woman. Hello,
Emily.
Hi, Emily.
Hello.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
So, Funny Frog Woman, tell us all about it. What is it, first of all?
We'll just have a sit down.
Let's get it up there.
So, Funny for Women is a podcast, comedy-based podcast. It represents, it was built as a platform to represent women in the arts, but specifically comedy. It started off as a uni project, as an MA that I'm doing, and has grown and is evolving sort of on a very local basis and slightly further afield, like London. I know. It's going far.
When did it start? So you say it's evolved.
So it started in January 2019 this year, so really new. But it has been growing. I've got a website that it's hosted on. And on the website, there are local artists and comedians, some musicians as well. Including Debs here, the lovely Debs.
I'm on there, yes.
Hold on.
Why not me?
Funny women.
Debs is brilliant.
She's
and very funny.
I've seen her. So
yeah, it's a real privilege, and I basically get to chat to awesome women and
interview them.
Yeah, so on the podcast, I interview women. They come and talk about their experiences of being a woman out there in the arts
and showbiz,
and choose two songs and give advice generally. And we've got a live podcast event which will have passed.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So what were your two songs then?
Well, my two songs...
No. Okay.
It was Magic Dance from Labyrinth Primal Scream Moving On Up.
Yeah, good choices.
They were good choices.
She's cool. Yeah. I knew you were cool,
everyone knew. You just took a bit of time to catch up.
Yeah, it takes me
How do you source... The women who come on the podcast, is it something you do yourself? So you find women that way?
Yeah, I've been on the production side of comedy for the last couple of years.
Okay.
So I have a good network of people that I can talk to, and I run a comedy event once a month as well funny women called Comedy Surgery. So I meet a lot of people through that invite them along to the podcast, and I get to help women share their stories, basically.
So Comedy Surgery, is that what it says on the tin? It says somewhere for comedians to come and kind of work on and get some treatment for what they're doing. Tell us a bit, because that sounds really interesting.
It is. It's great. So it's a night of two parts. Mm-hmm. The first part of the night is called Playtime, and it's for women that want to get involved with comedy or who are already on the circuit, might want to work on some material. Mm-hmm. We'll always have a special guest and host that will come along who's quite established in comedy, and they will do a bit of a workshop and some Q&A. And then the second part of the night is Showtime, which is an open mic where people get to do a five-minute spot.
Blimey.
Fantastic.
Well. Yeah.
And that's a monthly event?
That's a monthly event in Brighton at the Nightingale Room, yeah. Right.
Well, how does one get onto that? Do you contact you if there's any aspiring comedians?
Contact me and look on my website at funnyforwomen.com or on the Funny Women website.
Gotcha.
As well.
Okay.
Because as many of us did, I grew up watching comedy. I'm a child of the 80s, so I grew up watching French and Saunders, Victoria Wood.
Yeah.
So
amazing
women.
Yeah.
But there still is, it's still not easy being a female comedy act. There's still barriers to be broken down.
Absolutely.
Is that where Funny for Women is kind of kind of to support women around breaking down those barriers?
Yeah, and the name, I hope, is quite self-explanatory. I have had to explain it to a few people that think that I'm being misogynistic with the name, but actually it's supposed to be ironic, and obviously, because the amount of times over the years people said, you're quite funny for a woman.
Yeah.
And so that's how it was born. Yeah, to represent women. Everything's definitely moving in the right direction with women in the arts, and women are being becoming more represented. Mm-hmm. And I want to support that growth and do perhaps what the mainstream media don't do so much. Mm-hmm. So.
Good point, yeah, good point.
Excellent.
Most of the funniest people are women, to be honest.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I think
me.
So.
And Debs. No, there's lots of brilliant local female comedians, like people like Sam Savage, has been stitches all the time. She's
incredible.
Fantastic.
Yes.
There are so many, and it's amazing. It's amazing to see so many women getting the confidence to do it as well now. And it's really great. Yeah. So, an amazing community as well. Yeah. And so for anyone that wants to get involved, they should come and...
We should get an alternative on stopping men being on comedians, because some of them are just awful.
Well, I think it's about... personal.
I think there are some really funny men as well. And it's definitely not you know, anything against men, which...
When I've seen all men comedy nights, it's like, why do you think I know!
That's the thing.
That's how I feel. Mike...
You know.
That's a male stand-up, sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry, you're great. You'll be in Edinburgh, that'd be fantastic.
That's what the egos can be like sometimes. That is certainly what it can be like. But I do still find, and I don't know if you find this similarly, I do still sometimes see, and this is no disrespect to any promoters, but you do still get all-male lineups on comedy nights. And you do sometimes think, come on, there are so many great women out there who just need to be on those lineups, they need to be represented. Is that one of the things that Funny for Women is seeking, to kind of support female acts with actually being the ones kind of, you know, say, hello, I'm here, can you give me a chance?
Absolutely.
We've ejected that comedian, now he's gone. He's gone to reassess his career. Anyway, sorry.
Oh, bless him. Yeah, absolutely, because I think that's the thing. There are so many women out there, and it's not lack of talent, it's lack of opportunity for women. So it is giving women a platform to you know, basically want to say, look at these amazing women, and, you know, give them a voice and shine a light on the women that are out there, because,
But also, looking at your website and listening to your podcast and things, it's not just about stand-up. You represent women who are doing kind of character comedy, musical comedy. Sort of that, it's a big kind of umbrella, isn't it? And within the sort of workshop, the kind of the surgery, is it open to those kind of acts as
well? Absolutely, yeah. So it's open to anyone, really. But yeah, the comedy surgery is open to anyone in comedy. On the website, I have other artists as well and musicians that aren't comedy related. A digital artist is on there as well.
So you've kind of expanded
across the board. Yeah, I suppose it started off as sort of women, but has sort of gone more towards comedy. But I guess that's because of my own direction with it.
Are you a comedian yourself?
I am. Yes.
Did you start off on the kind of production kind of internet side of it and then get into comedy, or were you performing comedy first of all, or did they all kind of happened around the same time?
I love your body language.
I'm feeling very expressive today.
You are fantastic.
I've been on the production side, so promoting and producing it for the last couple of years. And I dated a comedian for a while. When we broke up, I thought I'd give it a go myself.
Oh, really?
So I thought I'd get myself out there.
The best revenge is being a better act than the person you dated. Not that I know, but I believe that to be true.
That's
she used to date Michael McIntyre.
And I'm much better than him.
No. Yes.
Oh, we're getting catty with this. Well, I mean, it's a big question, Emily, but what advice would you personally give to anyone, male, female, anybody wanting to get into comedy, wanting to get into that side of the arts? What's a good nugget of advice? What helped you?
What helped me? The piece of advice I would say is to just, if you want to do it, just go for it and get out of the way of yourself. A wise man once said to me that your want to make people laugh has to outweigh your fear of failure. And I think
your want to make people laugh has to outweigh your fear of failure.
Yeah, like with anything in life, really.
Get that on a t-shirt or a
tea
towel.
Yeah. Well, fear of failure also makes you do it as well, doesn't it? You just want to battle that fear, I guess.
Mm. But it's kind of, and actually knowing that if things go wrong, that's okay.
Exactly.
That's the thing. A big lesson. It's kind of, it is an up and down kind of process.
Absolutely. It's knowing that things will go wrong.
Yes.
And that it's okay, and it doesn't have to mean anything.
It's the thing about comedy that some people just don't find it funny, and it's not your fault sometimes. Mm. I remember the famous story at Monty Python. They were just about to get the television show, so they did a tour of the theatres, and they had one night where nobody laughed. Nobody laughed, and it was like, oh, are we doing it right? And it's self-belief.
That is the thing with comedy, isn't it? I think with actors, they can go and do their best and come away and they know that they've done their best. And even as a comedian, you'll come away, even if you have had laughs, wondering if you were funny or not anyway. So,
the thing about comedy is if somebody laughs, it's funny, I guess, and so you know you're a comedian.
But that's why it's good that Funny for a Woman can give that network of support for when, you know, people are feeling a little bit unsure. Sadly, we have come to the end.
End of part one.
That went really quickly.
It did go really quickly.
That went really, really quickly. So what does the future hold? What's next?
Well, I would like to...
In 10 seconds, less.
No pressure. Well, for it to continue to evolve and women to empower women.
Fantastic.
Exactly. Brilliant.
Thank you.
Emily.
See you next time.
Oh, right. Oh, hello. It's like you caught me unawares there. Brilliant. Welcome back. I'm so glad you stayed through those little messages. They were good. You're not Jason, you're not Debs.
No, I'm not. I'm Madeleine. Hi.
Hi, and
nice
I'm Andy.
To meet you.
And it's so nice to see you as well. We've got with us, for this half of the show, Harpreet.
Oh.
From, would you believe, the Hollingdean Red Tent Women's Circle. Mm. You know, we've got to ask her on just to tell us what that is.
Yes. 100%.
OK, Harpreet, would you come and join us, please?
Yeah.
Hi.
How
you great.
Doing?
I'm doing OK, thank you. You seem to have someone with you.
Yeah, we've got Orpheus.
Yay.
He's my son.
Hello, Orpheus.
He was sleeping, but he woke up. So
well, we have that effect on people. Normally it's the other way around. Red Tent.
So, yeah, the Red Tent is, it's like a woman's movement that really came from a book that was written by Anita Diamant.
Uh-huh.
But it's, women have been sitting in circle and creating safe and sacred spaces with one another since the beginning of time. But I think it really just evolved a lot from the book once it was published. And, it's a chance for women to come together during a moon cycle to sit and share and be in that space where, you can...
That sounds awesome. And I think the show obviously is based in Brighton and there's so many fantastic groups like this that kind of offer that space, because sometimes you do, I guess, as a woman, just having that kind of solidarity with other people that's sort of going through the similar things.
Yeah.
So in the title, Hollingdean, geographically based?
Yeah, basically there has been a Brighton and Hove Red Tent community for a long, long time.
All right.
I set up the Hollingdean Red Tent from my house because I'm a mother of a toddler and it's very, very difficult to get out. And for me, I really craved sitting in circle with other women and having that space where we can connect.
I do think that is really so important, and it's just, especially motherhood as well, and trying to get out of the house for a consistent amount of time is fantastic.
Can I please ask the men questions?
Yes, of course, off you go.
What's the gap that the women's circle is filling?
What is the gap?
Yes, what's the difference here that having this linked to the moon cycles, women coming together, that is filling that otherwise isn't there?
Well, red, I think, sort of gives it away a little bit.
Okay.
There is a time of the month for women.
Yes.
Where
I want a diagram, by the way. No, I don't. I don't. I wish I hadn't said that now. Anyway, yes.
You could. You could have a look, you know.
I think sometimes with guys, you do have to draw a bit of a diagram, don't you? And just kind of sit them down and go, look, this is what happens. And this is why it's important to have a space that's kind of dedicated to it as well. And I think, is it... So you base it inside your home. How many people do you have that join you?
It really depends. I mean, we can have just a few, 3, 4, 5, and then, usually last minute, there's a lot of people who sort of jump in.
Right. Yeah.
OK. I'm going to take you back to the it.
Yeah.
Yeah. can you say what the it is? Is it the emotional state that you go through at that time when your body is doing the physiological things that it is that the it that you're coalescing around, or is there some other it that I've not understood?
Well,
would you like to answer as a limerick? I don't know.
Yeah. So traditionally, women would come together at that time of the month. And yes. If you look historically to how women were also banned from being in certain places, they were told that they were dirty, they couldn't touch food, they couldn't go in sacred temples because of their moon cycle. So historically, women have come together at that time, and it's been a very potent time because we're very connected to nature on that level. So the red tent isn't just about women who are in their moon cycle all coming together and bleeding together. It's a space where we just connect to that energy of being with each other.
And also to get everyone synced up at the same time. That would be, you know, I know women are very good at multitasking, but, you know, to get everyone synced at the same time would be a fair challenge.
Is that a good thing? Because you're going to sync up with the exposure to the hormones and so on in that regular meeting. It, you know, the science shows us that. Is that a benefit?
When women are living together, yeah, they definitely start bleeding together.
Talk about housemates and things like that, don't they? Sort of members of the family.
Yeah, it happens.
So I just live up the road from you. So if I just wanted to come and just sort of hang out and enjoy the company of other women, what sort of does a session look like? Is there a kind of, do you have it at a fixed time? Do you have sort of fixed activities? What would I expect if I turned up?
If you came. So, first of all, you're most welcome.
Thank
you. All women are welcome. All women who identify as women are welcome. It's a bit political, that side of it,
I think, at the moment.
Yeah. But we keep it open to anybody who identifies as a woman or as a cisgendered woman.
Yeah.
And usually what we do is we set the intention for sacred space. Mm-hmm. So everyone comes in. We have some vegan food to share. Because, you know, you get hungry doing these things.
Food is good.
Yeah, we connect. We create a little ceremony, basically. Yeah. So we connect to nature through the elements. Mm-hmm. We maybe have a little meditation in the beginning. And the way that I co-create the space with the other women is that we usually have an altar in the middle, so people can bring things that they want to charge up, or use some divination cards.
Yeah.
So generally, every woman, if she wants to, has a chance to talk and be listened to, not necessarily have feedback if that's not right for her.
Okay.
And that it's completely confidential. So what happens in the circle stays in the circle, and we really maintain that confidence. Mm. So usually we try and set amount of time for about 3 hours, but when there's a lot of women together, things come up that you wouldn't usually feel might come up. So you might come to a circle thinking, I'd like to have some feedback or share this that's going on in my life, but then when it comes to it, maybe something else comes through.
Oh, I was just going to wonder, do you have any special skills? Because I can really understand the power of having an intimate group like that, where you have that a recognition that you can speak freely about this. Do you have any special skills if someone goes somewhere quite deep or particularly needy?
That's an interesting question. I mean, I ask myself all the time, what qualifies me to hold space? I work with people through my work. I work as a yoga teacher, so the type of yoga that I teach is quite transformative, and there's usually a lot of things coming up because you're going quite deep into the body. So I have some experience with breakdowns, let's say, but generally we hold the space together, so it's not all on me. It's a co-created space, and it's usually most women feel really comfortable to go into that place, and if they don't, it's not necessary.
Just thinking about future things, so you said that you've just had an event, so can you just give us a bit of information about how people can find you either online and kind of joining information about your stuff that you do within your home?
There are lots of red tents happening, so you can also plug social media Facebook, there's a Brighton and Hove Red Tent page. Yep. So there's lots of other women also hosting spaces.
We'll get
but for those, come, you just get in contact again through Solomorphy. That's my Facebook page, and you'll be more than welcome.
That's absolutely brilliant. Harpreet, I thank you a lot for that, and I know that you're distracted in that way, but this is what happens when we feel loved. Joy to talk about the Red Tent thing, and from my point of view, it's an insight to a part of the world that I wouldn't normally have had, I think.
Well, I think, as I said, it's kind of being a woman, it's something that happens. And I was just saying earlier about what happens, like, back in the day, that if you're just a woman, womanly things, to be punished for that. And sort of cast out from society. I mean, that kind of sucks. And that's why these spaces are important, because whilst that doesn't happen these days, you know, that is kind of in our, I guess, in our sort of history, really. So I think that's really great,
isn't it? It's incredible.
Fantastic. So any kind of final questions, I guess?
Not really. I really do thank you for coming on. And torturing him so. We're normally much nicer to people, really.
Fantastic. So, I think, Andy, you're very welcome. If you would like to go, you're very welcome.
Thank you.
We
thank
just
you
need to talking. Wrap up this show and thinking about the next one. So.
Delights are coming up on the very next show. We have Brighton School.
We do. Now, this is slightly different performance, isn't it?
Well, yes, I was promised 3 to 4 singers, so we may have a little bit of a surprise.
And are you going to be taking part?
I don't know. Me? Yeah, I get paid not to do karaoke, so no, I won't. We also have Only in Brighton coming on.
Ooh, what's that about?
That's tours. That's stuff in the city that you won't have known about. So tune in next week. Well, I will be Jason, and you will be Debs.
I will be Debs. Bye-bye. Thank you.